presentation today is about Charcot-Marrow osteoarthropathy of the foot and ankle joints. Charcot osteoarthropathy is a destructive joint disorder that was first described in detail in 1868 by Jane Morton Charcot, based on reports of patients afflicted with squamous bursitis. The association with diabetes was put forward by Jordan when he described a case of Charcot-Marrow osteoarthropathy in a diabetic patient in 1936. Today, diabetes mellitus is the most common etiology associated with Charcot osteoarthropathy, with the joints of the foot and ankle being most commonly affected. Other causes of Charcot-Marrow osteoarthropathy include cases of cellulitis, cerebromyalgia, leprosy, heavy metal poisoning, congenital sensory neuropathy, alcoholic neuropathy, and major trauma to peripheral nerves. In such conditions, Charcot-Marrow osteoarthropathy is not restricted to the foot and ankle, but it can affect the shoulders, elbows, spine, hips, and knees. Diabetes mellitus leads to systemic hyperglycemia, and this will lead to glycosylation of proteins throughout the body, intracellular formation of sorbitol and other alcohols, disruption of the regulation of reactive oxygen species leading to the production of large amounts of oxygen-free radicals. All these factors will lead to damage of the cellular proteins, membrane lipids, and nuclear materials. Also, there is decreased nitrous oxide production leading to vasoconstriction, nerve ischemia, and decreased production of neurotrophic factors. There are two well-recognized theories for the pathogenesis of Charcot osteoarthropathy. The first is a neurotraumatic theory, and the second is a neurovascular theory. The neurotraumatic theory was put forward by Charcot himself, and in this case, we have abnormal sensation that leads to loss of the protective reflexes. So you have repeated micro trauma leading to periarticular fractures and dislocations. Those patients, when they have fractures and dislocations, they don't feel their legs, so they continue to weight bear, and this leads to the hypertrophic osteoarthropathy. In the neurovascular theory, you have peripheral neuropathy that leads to impairment of the autonomic function, and this leads to sympathetic overaction, leading to hyperemia, leading to osteolysis and bone loss, leading to weakness of the bones and fractures. The clinical picture was described, was staged in 1936 by Eichenholz, who categorized the clinical picture into three stages. The first stage, which is the destruction stage, in this case we have acute inflammatory process. The foot is swollen, hyperemic, and most patients report pain in spite of the sensory neuropathy. So this is very important. At this stage, the x-ray is usually free. You don't have any x-ray symptoms at that stage. The destructive changes, fractures and subluxations occur at the end of this stage with the start of stage two. So the differential diagnosis at stage one includes gout, arthritis, fractures, venous insufficiency, tumors, and infection. Magnetic resonance imaging is very important at that stage, and it is a keystone for the diagnosis of patients in stage one. That's an example, a case with normal x-ray, and here we can see significant MRI changes, hyper-intense signal in T2 image, including the navicular and cuneiforms. In the second stage, which is the coalition stage, is characterized by coalescence of new bone at the fracture sites and regression of the inflammatory causes, regression of the edema, redness, hyperemia, and so on. And we can see clearly the fractures and dislocations. In stage three, it is the resolution stage, and it means healing of the problem, but usually you will have atrophy, as we can see here, and we can see, as you can see well, the deformity, especially the local bottom deformity in midfoot break. Some of the cases, and definitely that deformity will lead to pressure ulcers, as we can see. Brodsky classified Charcot types into three types. Type 1, including the tarsometatarsal and labicular cuneiform joint. Type 2 involves the subtalar, talo-labicular and calcaneal cuneiform joints. And type 3 is subdivided into type 3A, where the ankle is involved, and type 3B, where the calcaneal tuberosity is broken. When we move to treatment, the standard treatment for early Charcot osteoarthropathy is prolonged external immobilization. This is very important. It can protect the patients from break and from deformity later on. And this prolonged immobilization might take up to 2 years. Patients are put in total contact cast or a walker. I personally prefer the cast. Those patients are usually non-reliable at this stage. But this is the type of walker we can use later on. This is one of our patients. She had something that looked like cellulitis, x-ray showing fracture at the base of the metatarsals. And this is after 3 months in cast, 3 months in brace, and this is at 1 year with minimum deformity. Surgical treatment options include resecting the infected bones, removing bony prominences, and correcting deformities by arthrodesis. In most cases, they focused on the reconstruction of the deformity by reduction and arthrodesis using standard methods of internal fixation. But because we have poor bone quality, some people or some authors advise to extend the fixation to normal bones. This is what they call the super construct. And also, because of the soft tissue problems, some people prefer external fixators and bizarre frames. That's one of the important papers published by San Marco in the JBGS in 2009 about mid-arthral arthrodesis in the treatment of Charcot midfoot arthropathy. They do open reduction and arthrodesis. They use screws. This is one of the cases. And this is after correction of the deformity using multiple axial placed intramural screws. They had 22 patients. They had complete osseous union in 16 patients, partial union in 5 cases, and non-union in 1 case. Again, another paper about the super construct. They, here they use plantar plates. They use locked plates to improve the quality of fixation. And this is another paper, again published in the Diabetic Foot and Ankle in 2010. They use medial plate, as we can see here. And if the bone quality is poor, they combine internal fixation together with the resorb fixator. This is one of their cases with midfoot break. And they fix it. They corrected the deformity using a medial plate together with the resorb. Later on, they removed the resorb and kept the plate in. But in fact, most of the foot deformities are, to some extent, better tolerated by diabetic patients compared with the ankle joint, which leads to usually to varus and valgus deformity. And even if you try to protect your patient using a brace, then because of the deformity, there will be friction between the bones and the brace, and usually you will have large ulcers. One of the methods is to use قريت له ري كالكينيوم ارثوديل نيل سوري قريت له ري كالكينيوم نيل فور ارثوديزيس. Sometimes you can combine intramedullary nails together with external fixators like Resolve, like in this case, to shorten the duration of the external fixation. Let's skip this. Now we, I will show some of our cases that we treated by bifocal ankle arthrodesis. This is actually my first patient. He had bimanular fracture that was fixed by internal fixation failure. Another trial with internal fixation, 3 months in cast non-repairing, it seems better. But again, when he started repairing, everything was like this. So he has a vast deformity, cannot tolerate the brace, so we went for the bifocal ankle arthrodesis. I mean, I do shortening, at I remove all, I open through the transmalleolar, translateral malleolar approach, I remove all fragile dead bones, I fuse the tibia to the talus or the tibia to the calcaneus, it depends on the amount of bone resected, and then I compensate for the shortening by proximal tibial osteotomy and lengthening, even in those diabetic old-aged patients. This is after surgery. You can see the fusion site and the proximal corticotomy. This is during lengthening or after lengthening and solid fusion of the tibia to the talus. Another patient with vast deformity, a large skin ulcer. She was around 35 years old at that time, extensive destruction of the talus. We removed the talus and we fused the tibia to the calcaneus. We did the proximal osteotomy. This is how the skin ulcer healed without any plastic surgery. And this is during lengthening, and sorry, after lengthening and solid fusion of the ankle. This is how she looked like after removal of our frame. Another patient, again, destruction of the ankle was like mostly like septic arthritis. The same was done, tibial fusion together with proximal lengthening. This is at the end. Follow up, solid fusion proximally and distally. More follow up. Solid fusion. Another patient, he had severe valgus deformity, as you can see. Very difficult to fit in a brace. Extensive destruction and dislocation of the ankle joint. Same again, fusion of the tibia to the calcaneus, proximal tibial osteotomy. This is a patient in the frame during lengthening. After removal of the frame, and you can see now he is having a plantigrade foot without problems. He came at that time to see me for this arthritis. Another patient, the same again, just a fracture in the medial malleus, was treated in cast, but it ended up with this. Disaster, virus, again proximal corticotomy and tibial talar fusion, lengthening and compression of the ankle, proper fusion at the ankle and the proximal tibial regenerate. This is how she looked like at the end. This was a disastrous case. You can see she has amputation in the big toe of the left foot. Multiple scars in the right leg and foot, looks scary. If you see the lateral minus, the lateral aspect of the ankle shows a large ulcer, another ulcer in the sole of the foot. She was very keen to have her, to keep her leg, and she was insisting to go for surgery. I refused. We can see it's not the calcaneus, it's a very small remnant of the calcaneus remaining here. We used the tibias, this remnant. In this case, I used intramedullary pains to improve the fixation, and I extended the frame to the forefoot to heal. And this is during this traction. And this is after removal of the frame with solid unit of the regenerate and proper healing at the ankle. This is after skin healing, so follow up. Another case, another disastrous one, very large ulcer, no tails, same procedure, skin healed, the ulcer healed without any plastic surgery. 6 months, she was doing quite well, but she had some breakage of one of the proximal wires. She refused to take it out, and it seems that this wire cut through into the knee joint and caused septic arthritis of the knee. And this was one of the bad complications. We can see some resorption in the medial part of the upper tibia. We removed the frame, we put in cast, and she had another collection. I did the debridement, but she had another collection. Then I had to open the knee through a medial part of an approach. We can see significant destruction in the knee joint, but the infection healed, and she's now walking with a brace, and she's happy with her results, but I'm not happy. This is the final X-ray, and this is the final clinical appearance. I went to monofocal arthrodesis of the ankle in such cases in two situations. The first situation is when you don't have so much destruction. And in this case, for example, the amount of bone to be removed is small, so you don't need to do bifocal treatment. This is an MRI showing the affection. And this is just by arthrodesis. And it went quite well. This is after removal of the frame and putting her in cast, but she's from Libya and she did not appear again. Another patient with extensive destruction, but this patient was about 150 kilograms. And I was expecting that she's so difficult to manage, except on the operative tape. Even handling the leg or moving the leg around was very difficult. So I decided not to go for bifocal treatment, I just went for monofocal treatment. This patient also is from Saudi Arabia. And this is after fixation again with wires, fixation of the calcaneus to the tibia, or the remnants of the calcaneus to the tibia, to be honest. And this is after application of the frame. She did quite well, and it healed. And this is her final X-ray with bone movement at the arthrodesis site. And she's extremely delighted with the results. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Benovico, for managing them. A very difficult, complicated cases. Any questions?
Doctor, I have to say that I really appreciate your work, because these cases are the most debilitating cases. In the United States, we all say charcoal joints would drive any surgeon crazy.
Yes.
And they're crazy also. So.
Yes, that's why I'm crazy.
Yeah. I have a quick question for you, and I was talking to the doctor yesterday. What is your rate of destruction on the proximal tibia, being a diabetic, and your latency period?
I usually go for Arbor Elizarov in all cases. And
what is your rate of destruction?
It's the same, 1 millimeter a day.
But 2 weeks, 2 weeks of latency. And then the other question is, now in at this time in your career, when would you consider internal fixation versus external fixation?
I definitely prefer external fixators. But I think that retrograde titanium day is an option in cases where you still have a very good bone stock and don't have infection. But if you have infection or you have efficient bone stock, then definitely you will go for Elisa.
Thank you. One more question. How would you explain the in a neuropathic foot that in the stage one they're painful?
They don't have complete loss of sensation. They still have some sensation. If you examine a diabetic patient, you can see that he's feeling the superficial touch or pinprick before, but he doesn't feel his toe and he lost his deep sensation. So it seems that the posterior column is affected first.